The country's State Weather Bureau retires a new batch of typhoon names due to the damage that they've brought. Pag-asa says the names Egay and Goring are now officially decommissioned. A typhoon's name is retired from Pag-asa's list once it causes at least 300 deaths or 1 billion peso worth of damage to crops and infrastructure. Typhoon Egay, which hit the country in July last year, killed 30 people and left damage amounting to 15.3 billion pesos. Goring, meanwhile, brought about 2 deaths and over 2 billion pesos in damage. More Filipinos suffered from hunger last December. That's according to the latest SWS survey, which showed 12.6% of Filipinos said they experienced involuntary hunger in December of last year. That is slightly higher than the 9.8% recorded in September of the same year. Now, of that figure, 1.4% said they experienced severe hunger. Mindanao saw a big spike in hunger last month, while Metro Manila's numbers went down. And although the 2023 annual average rate of 10.7% is slightly lower compared to 2022, but still higher than the pre-pandemic level of 9.3%, these results come against a backdrop of stubbornly elevated inflation. The Philippine Economic Zone Authority turns to Japanese financial giant Sumitomo Mitsui Banking and local bank RCBC to help promote the Philippines to foreign investors. As Andrea Taguines tells us, PEZA expects to gain more investments, particularly in the EV industry, which could aid the Marcos administration's jeepney modernization program. Let's watch this.
The Philippine Economic Zone Authority, or PEZA, partners with Japan's Sumitomo Mitsui Banking Corporation and local bank RCBC to attract more foreign investors into the Philippines. That's as the country plays catch-up with its ASEAN neighbors in terms of foreign direct investment inflows. PEZA Director General Teresa Opanga said, under the Memorandum of Understanding signed on Tuesday, SMBC would serve as PEZA's bridge to a broader network of international investors.
From experience kasi, in our dealings even with regional banks, they're the ones bringing in the investors. Even small banks, like in we were one time in Osaka, so we were surprised that they're bringing in a lot of SMEs. But you know, they may be SMEs in Japan, but they're actually large corporations the moment they register in the Philippines.
Other Asian countries also try to attract foreign investors. I think among those, I could fairly say that the Philippines is quite taking in a good position. Population, the younger generation, well educated, of course, apparently English speakers. So those are the competitive edges of Philippines.
One upcoming project under the MOU is an investor seminar in Japan in March, which will be attended by SMBC's clients.
Obviously, we're looking at Japan being our number one source of investments, even exports for the longest time, even jobs. So we will continue to do that. In fact, we will be more aggressive.
Meanwhile, Panga said the collaboration with RCBC could streamline processes within economic zones, making it easier for locators to start their business operations in the Philippines. RCBC President and CEO Eugene Acevedo also committed to providing better financial services to EcoZone employees.
I think what is more important is that together, we are able to provide more services to their employees that are not always readily available. No. Things like, simple things like salary advances, remittances, making it easy for them to send money to their families.
Panga expects the export manufacturing sector to benefit greatly from the additional foreign investments that will come in, as well as the electric vehicle industry. He said EcoZones are also open to local manufacturers looking to participate in the government's jeepney modernization push.
This type of activities like EVs, they're really essentially catering to the domestic market. I'm sure many local companies will be integrated into the EcoZone value chain, particularly in EV manufacturing. If they locate in a PEZA zone, they will enjoy fiscal incentives, but more importantly, the non-fiscal incentives, particularly ease of doing business.
Iconic Filipino jeepney maker Francisco Motors is in the process of setting up shop in an eco zone in Camarines Norte to produce more affordable e-jeepneys. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
Starbucks in the spotlight last week after it was exposed that the popular coffee chain had placed a cap on discounts for senior citizens and persons with disabilities. But as Vivian Guglia tells us, some 2,000 complaints have been filed against other commercial establishments over denied discounts and benefits. Take a look.
Around 2,000 complaints on denied discounts and benefits for senior citizens and persons with disability were filed before concerned government agencies. An inquiry of joint House panels revealed on Tuesday. Of this number, 154 were filed before the National Council on Disability Affairs, while the rest are filed before the National Commission for Senior Citizens. The NCDA said among the complained establishments are restaurants and hotels. A representative of the Hotel and Restaurant Association of the Philippines raised the difficulty of verifying PWD identification cards amid the alleged proliferation of fake IDs.
Some of the concerns that we may have are with the proliferation of fake IDs or the 1,700 different types of PWD cards, which is quite difficult to really compare with any National Registry.
Quijano, meanwhile, lamented that some delivery apps still have no option for availing senior citizen or PWD discounts. Some lawmakers also called out the difficulty in finding such options in some websites and apps for online transactions.
It exists, but it is hidden. It is very difficult to find.
That's the current system limitation on our website, but we'll work with our web team on this to make it
more. Para PWD friendly kayo. Yung birthday kasi, pag lumabas yung birthday, pwede ba yun? Default nyo na.
Meanwhile, San Miguel Corporation has given assurance that its toll waste group is studying how to implement the 20% discount in toll fees. SMC operates the NAIA Expressway, Skyway, South Luzon Expressway, Southern Tagalog Arterial Road, and Tarlac Pangasinan La Union Expressway.
We would like to manifest our support to the mentioned discounting of the various services for the PWDs and the senior citizens.
Nagdagan mo na lang ng mileage. When we pay you 5, why don't you give them credits for 6? For those vehicles that belong to senior citizen. That is my proposal. That's the proposal of the joint committee. No discounting, just add on.
After being called out by lawmakers over a signage that limited the grant of senior citizen and PWD discounts to just one food item and one beverage per visit in the last hearing, Starbucks Philippines announced on its social media page that it will grant 40% discount on all food and beverage for these sectors, as well as for national athletes, eligible solo parents, and Medal of Valor recipients on January 24th. Salceda commended the coffee shop chain for its compensatory effort. The House panels formed a technical working group to work on a remedial legislation that will seek to address the gaps in the implementation of benefits for senior citizens and PWDs. Vivian Guglia, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine government seeking to double the country's halal output in the next 4 years. The Trade Department on Tuesday launched the country's Halal Industry Development Strategic Plan, which aims to increase Philippine-made halal certified products and services to 6,000 by 2028 from the current 3,000. Currently, only goods certified by Philippine-accredited halal certifying bodies are allowed to be exported. The DTI aims to widen the country's share in the global halal industry, which is expected to reach $7.7 trillion next year. Muslims currently account for 25% of the global population, or 1.9 billion people. This is projected to grow further to 2.8 billion by 2050.
Our strategic plan is to transform the Philippines into a premier halal hub in the Asia Pacific over the coming 4 years. Execution of our halal strategic plan will see a doubling of our current 3,000 halal certified products and services to 6,000, catering to both the burgeoning domestic demand and the global halal market. To achieve this, we will foster collaborative efforts among government agencies, attract 230 billion pesos in foreign investments, and in the process create 120,000 new jobs over the next 4 years.
The Philippine Chamber of Agriculture and Food doubling down on its call to eliminate the minimum access volume, or MAV, asserting that failure to do so would result in corruption. The MAV was introduced nearly 30 years ago. It's a tariff-setting policy that assigns lower duties to a certain quantity of agricultural imports. In a meeting last week with the chief of the Philippine Agriculture Portfolio, the group suggested that the Philippines should instead impose a uniform 35% tariff on all agricultural products entering the country.
The MAV, being updated, should be reviewed because the MAV, or the minimum access volume, is a source of corruption. This certificate of MAV, for some, but from what I know, understand, it's being traded. You know? If you are given an MAV, you sell it to another trader. What is, during the discussion with Secretary Laurel, then the discussion of why not put in a unified tariff? The idea for the minimum access volume is to make sure that we import a certain volume from the participant countries of WTO. We are importing from them.
Right.
So why give a different tariff rate? And this tariff rate, because of the discretion, what to give? Is it an MAV certificate, or is it an inbound quota, or is it outbound quota? It could be a source of corruption or technical smuggling. So to simplify matters and be simple, the proposal really is to remove the MAV, because mm-hmm. the MAV, I think, is already outdated and it's not necessary anymore. The tariff of 35% is still subject for consultation and review. Those tariffs that were taken from these commodities be flown back to the commodity sector to develop them.
The Miss Universe organization and its owner, Thailand-based JKN Global Group, well, they've partnered with a Mexican business conglomerate, Legacy Holdings CEO and President Raul Rocha. A longtime pageant fan is joining JKN Global founder and CEO Anne Jacla Jutatip as the co-owner of the merged privately held company JKN Legacy. The ownership scheme? 50-50. Legacy Holdings will lead preparations for the 73rd Miss Universe in Mexico this year and will enhance the Miss Universe brand profile, exploring new products and marketing opportunities globally. It was also announced that a Filipina, Olivia Kidoko, will serve as the Vice President for Global Partnerships, collaborating closely with Miss Universe franchise holders and national directors worldwide.